Every 42 seconds, somebody is arrested for cannabis.
Stop arresting patients! Stop arresting patients! Stop arresting patients!
Welcome to CMMNJ-TV.
Every 42 seconds, someone is arrested for marijuana.
I'm Ken Walsky, Executive Director of the Coalition for Medical Marijuana New Jersey. The mission of our organization is to educate the public about the benefits of marijuana. Marijuana is a safe, effective, and inexpensive therapeutic agent for a wide variety of diseases, symptoms, and conditions. No patient should suffer needlessly without it, and no patient should ever go to jail for following the advice of a doctor. Join us and learn more about the exciting science of medical marijuana. Welcome to CMMNJ-TV. I'm Ken Walsky, Executive Director of the Coalition for Medical Marijuana New Jersey. I'm here in the Princeton Community TV studios today with Dr. David Nathan from Princeton University, from Princeton. So welcome.
Thank you very much, Dr. Nathan.
So you're a psychiatrist and you have a private practice here in Princeton.
That's correct, Absolutely.
And you're also with the head of education from Princeton Healthcare System?
Yeah, I'm the head of the continuing medical education department at the Princeton Healthcare System, that's correct. Mm-hmm. Though I should note that in this capacity, I don't represent the hospital.
Right. But nevertheless, I did go to a educational program that you had at Princeton House, mm-hmm. where you brought in Dr. Jehan Marcou, one of the leading researchers from on the endocannabinoid system.
Right.
So I was very impressed with that.
That was actually, I have to give credit to one of my colleagues for actually having come up with that particular speaker. But I agree that he was great in speaking about the state of the science.
Yeah, I mean, exactly. I mean, there is, you know, this entirely new system in the human body, the endocannabinoid system, and just very few people are aware of it, and mm-hmm. It's just not getting the attention that I think mm-hmm. it deserves.
And I don't know if things have changed now, but I can tell you that as a medical student, as a resident, there isn't really a whole lot that's taught about the endocannabinoid system. And in the defense of medical education, I think some of that was just because there wasn't the perceived need. But I think it's also, interestingly, the nature of the plant, that because it itself does not serve any life sustaining functions, the toxicity of it is less of a concern, which I think is one of the issues that brings me here, is the lack of toxicity and the position that I have on this issue.
That's a good thing. You know, we did a research, there was research done actually by Dr. David Allen from California, who said that only 14% of the medical schools in the United States even mention the endocannabinoid system. And here you have a system that regulates many processes in mm-hmm. the body, and yet it's and it's non-toxic, mm-hmm. And yet it's not really being taught. Mm-hmm. I'm wondering, I noticed that you don't take any money from pharmaceutical companies in your practice, and I wonder how common that is among physicians. You know, there seems to be a great influence of the pharmaceutical, a multi-billion-dollar industry,
sure.
Not only in physicians but also in lobbying and
absolutely.
Kind of laws that we see.
Absolutely, and I certainly can't claim never to have accepted anything mm-hmm. Other than the usual pens and such. Back in the day, before I really thought about such issues, mm-hmm. I would go to dinners and I would attend functions that were paid for by drug companies. Mm-hmm. I would give a talk on a subject of my choice and be paid an honorarium by the drug companies. The change really came both from an awakening of the ethical issues involved in that, and also the fact that as the continuing medical education director, I wanted it to be clear that I was not being influenced by any corporate interest in trying to educate other physicians.
Well, I think that's really extremely admirable, and I compliment you on that. I just wonder how big an influence the pharmaceutical industry really does have, both in our laws and in physician education. I think
sure.
it's pretty profound.
And I can't say that I can't speak to the issue of laws. Mm-hmm. That's just not my area of expertise. Mm-hmm. But I can say that that as far as physician education goes, there's a reason that so much money is spent by pharmaceutical companies on physician education and communications with physicians, and they wouldn't be doing it if it wasn't in some way profitable.
Right.
Now, not to say that you can't get some good education through the events that are sponsored by them. For example, when a new drug comes out, it's important that physicians learn about it, mm-hmm. and it's not a terrible idea to learn about it from the corporate interest that actually produces it. At the same time, I don't think that doctors' choices should be guided by who most recently came to their office and gave them the biggest smile and the best samples.
That's very good. Why we invited you here today really is to talk about your involvement with New Jersey United for Marijuana Reform. Mm-hmm. So it's so refreshing, I think, to have a physician, a respected member of the community, to have an important role in this group working for marijuana reform. How did you come to be involved in it?
So I guess you can date this back about 6 years, toward the end of 2009, after years of seeing lives ruined by marijuana, not so much by the drug itself. I treat only adults, and of the adults that I would treat, I saw lives devastated by marijuana. Again, not by the drug, but by the legal system that was using a sledgehammer to kill a weed. Mm-hmm. And I was really increasingly angry about the ways that our laws were counterproductive, that they not only didn't serve the public interest in public health, but they actually were harmful to our nation. And eventually it got to the point where I felt like I had to speak up. And so I wrote an opinion piece that was run in the Wall Street Journal, thinking that, okay, I'll just lend my voice to the many that have spoken up from the physician community on this issue, only to find out once the article had run that not that many physicians have really spoken up. And while it's been gradually over the years that I've gotten more involved in this movement, it was quite a surprise to me that my voice was not often heard, or the point of view that I was espousing was not often heard. Now that's changing. I would say the part of the reason I was surprised was that in private conversations with other physicians all the time, we would share with each other that, yeah, it's ridiculous that marijuana is against the law, because we as physicians who treat substance misuse, we see, of course, terrible problems with alcohol. We see problems with heroin and cocaine mm-hmm. and methamphetamine and all the drugs that we imagine to be really devastating to individuals' lives. But marijuana wasn't generally on that list. Now, with the caveat that I don't treat kids, among adults, there is very little harm that's done by that drug among occasional users. Mm-hmm. It's not to say that it's harmless, of course, to individuals who are predisposed to psychiatric disorders. It can actually either trigger an episode, for example, of a psychotic disorder in unusual circumstances, not common, but it happens. It can also exacerbate a mood or anxiety disorder. Of course, you'll also hear individuals tell you that actually it improved their mood or anxiety disorder. And as I'm sure your audience knows, it's increasingly being used in post-traumatic stress disorder, especially mm-hmm. by veterans. Mm-hmm. The main issue in marijuana legalization, the main concern that physicians should have, whether or not they do or not is a matter of individual choice, but the real concern should be creating a distinction in use between children and adults. And I'm talking about personal use, not medical use. You know, medical use for children with refractory seizures that aren't being well treated by other medications, okay, they are kids for whom marijuana use may be appropriate. For personal, or you could say recreational use, creating a distinction between adults and a somewhat arbitrary number of 21 years or older versus minors is a very important distinction. So when our society is making no distinction between adult and underage use when it's illegal for everybody. The message that we're sending is that marijuana is bad for everyone. And kids, my kids, I have a 15 and an 11-year-old, two children, they know that there's a big difference, mainly because I've taught that to them and they've heard me speak on this subject, and they understand that what is a generally safe activity for adults is neither safe nor legal, nor should it be legal for minors. And by creating that distinction, we will, for the first time in decades, for nearly 100 years, send the message that what is a safe and acceptable activity for adults is neither safe nor acceptable for minors. Right now, the system that we have, the system of prohibition, tries to send the message that it's bad for everyone, and kids know that's not true.
Yeah, and you wonder how much sense it really makes when you say minors should not use marijuana, but adults should not use marijuana.
Right.
That's not a reasonable regulation. That's just a blanket prohibition that I think Americans are pretty much fed up with.
Right, and the polls reflect that, of course, and the media reflects that. When you see lighthearted discussions about adult use of marijuana in the media, either in the news, as is increasingly happening, or in entertainment, what you're seeing is the realization by adults that, come on, we know it's not that bad. We can agree on that. That, for example, alcohol is a more dangerous and more harmful drug across populations. We know that. It may not make that distinction between adult use and childhood use, though kids watching this will certainly learn that for adults, it's not that big a deal, and if we try to convince them that nobody should be using it for personal use, that doing so is bad enough that we should put people in prison for that, kids know we're lying to them, and they're not going to listen to us, and they're not going to listen to us when we tell them they shouldn't use it either.
I think they've stopped listening to us already.
Well, sure. I mean, the statistic that is really most impressive to me is that the government's own statistics, the National Institute on Drug Abuse, for decades has been gathering data on 18-year-olds and their use of various drugs and their access to various drugs. And what that has shown is that for decades, over 80% and generally closer to 90% of minors, 18-year-olds, report that marijuana is either fairly easy or very easy to obtain, if they want it. And you know, I kind of wanted to cross-check this against some anecdotal evidence, so I asked my niece, who at the time was probably 15 or 16 years old, a very sweet young girl who, by her very candid description, has I tend to believe her when she says that she's never tried this stuff. I at least hope that's the case. But she, who's a pretty straight-laced kid, I asked her, could you get it if you wanted it? And she lives in a fairly crime-free, drug-free community. And I asked her that question, and her answer was, she kind of chuckled, and she said, yes, Uncle David, I could get marijuana if I wanted marijuana. And I asked her, how would that compare to alcohol? And she said, well, marijuana is easier to get because marijuana is sold illegally. And so, you know, kids can get it the same way adults can, as opposed to alcohol, where you have to have some form of ID, which, you know, unless kids fake ID, then they're not going to get it.
So we can actually protect children more by creating a system of regulation.
Absolutely.
Of marijuana that is sold like alcohol in with people coming in and showing ID cards in licensed facilities?
Correct. Yeah, no, absolutely. I feel very strongly about that. And, you know, as a physician, I'm not advocating the use of marijuana in adults or kids, certainly not in kids. And in adults, occasional use, I think, is not so bad, and it's probably not as bad as alcohol. But if we want to take this problem of underage use seriously, then what we need to do is get it out of the parks and off of the street corners and out of the hands of illegal dealers who will sell to anybody. They're not asking for ID. They're already breaking the law, so they don't really make a distinction between customers who are adults versus customers who are minors. And then put it behind the counter with somebody who is regulated by the government, whose livelihood depends upon their compliance with the law. And they will check for ID. And indeed, when they've done studies in Colorado, what they found is very few, almost no incidents of sales to undercover officers posing as minors who don't provide sufficient ID. It virtually never happens. And that's not surprising.
But how about the education that's possible? I mean, once we stop demonizing marijuana and considering it, you know, the devil's weed, the weed with roots in hell, you know, can't we really begin to normalize its presence in our society?
And
make it less of a forbidden fruit and attractive substance for teens as well. I mean, honest educational efforts, that's what's kind of brought down the tobacco use among teens.
I've seen arguments from people who oppose the legalization of marijuana where they say we're sending the wrong message to teens by legalizing it. And first of all, as I was just explaining, I think that the wrong message is that it's harmful adult for equally for adults and kids, and that's why the same law applies to both. I think that's very harmful to make that case because you're supporting something that kids simply will not believe. And that aside, since when have kids listened to an I told you so argument about something where they have evidence to the contrary? So if the message that they want to send is that you shouldn't use it, why? Because we told you so, because that's the law. Certainly we should respect the law. But when there are laws that aren't worthy of respect, I don't think you're going to get a lot of enthusiasm from children and from teens about following that law. And that's why the law needs to change.
Yeah, and it I find it ironic, too, that if these laws are made to protect children, what do we do with people who break the laws? You know, we arrest the children, we arrest their parents.
Right.
You know, the collateral consequences of these arrests for marijuana can have devastating effects on not only individuals but entire communities when these arrests disproportionately impact various communities rather than other communities.
And you know, if there was a straw that broke the camel's back in my speaking up about this and not being willing to keep silent anymore and not being willing to have these private conversations with friends and family and colleagues about this, but actually, in a sense, putting my reputation on the line about this issue and feeling that certain about the need to legalize it, it was hearing from a patient who was on his way to college and because of a marijuana arrest, lost a scholarship and lost, you know, had a criminal record after that. And his life went in a very different direction. And his life could have been quite different had he not been arrested for that and had the law not come down as hard on him as it had.
Yeah, those collateral consequences, civil penalties, loss of driver's license, fines, loss of scholarships, as you point out,
which has nothing to do with the personal use of a reasonably non-toxic substance. You know, maybe it's not good for you, but it's not that bad for you.
Expel your entire family from public housing.
You
know, it's just devastating
I don't know, you know, I think a lot of the people who are opposed to marijuana reform and full legalization for personal use, I don't think they're, I certainly don't doubt their sincerity and their motivations for wanting to protect the public. I don't think that they realize the devastation that's caused by marijuana laws and how much more harm is done by the laws than could ever be done by marijuana use.
Yeah. It's not only ineffective policy in stopping marijuana use, but also counterproductive, as you said. It's just, it causes more problems than it creates.
Sure.
Certainly we believe that here at the Coalition for Medical Marijuana in New Jersey, although our organization was formed about a dozen years ago solely for medical marijuana, we have come in the last year or two endorse legalization of marijuana. So,
and I imagine, I mean, you can tell me if it's otherwise, but if I were sitting where you're sitting, my thought would be that, you know, given how there has been difficulty with access to marijuana, and people have been arguing which indication would qualify and which form it could be sold in, certainly in the state of New Jersey, the laws have been restrictive and counterproductive. A lot of these problems go away once you have full legalization.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, you don't need you don't need to see someone. You know, many times diagnoses are either poorly diagnosed, misdiagnosed, or people just never go to a doctor in the first place. They think that what they have is a normal situation when they're really on a spectrum of some kind of mental or emotional disorder, and they find that marijuana is helpful in helping them to cope with their life struggles, and yet yet they would never have a diagnosis that would qualify in certainly in New Jersey.
Right, that's correct. And you know, to give the fullness of my opinion, I would say that for patients with psychiatric disorders, as I mentioned before, the use of marijuana can cut both ways. Don't think that it's, I certainly don't think it's a panacea. And whether it has psychiatric indications or not, there are certainly cases of people who should not smoke marijuana. And honestly, the ones for whom that's true, they generally figure it out and they stop. And the reason that they stop is that, as we know, it's not nearly as physiologically addicting as other recreational drugs such as alcohol or tobacco, and it's not even as physiologically habit-forming as caffeine.
Right. Now, well, let's talk about that a little bit. Now, you say that marijuana can precipitate a psychotic event in someone predisposed to schizophrenia. I think that's a reasonable thing to say. I don't think it's reasonable. What some people have said is that marijuana causes schizophrenia.
Well, I'd like to address that because I have colleagues who assert that, and that's a very serious question. You know, if that is the case that it causes schizophrenia, that's a different thing. The evidence really isn't there. I mean, there is evidence. You know, there have been studies to suggest that maybe it does contribute to the risk of schizophrenia. There's also evidence to suggest that there is no risk. Just like with lung cancer, I know this is a bit of an aside, but with lung cancer, there was the question of whether it caused lung cancer. Well, a very large study that was done at UCLA seemed to even have a negative correlation between marijuana use and lung cancer, which is not to say that inhaled smoke, which is the form in which they were studying it, is good for your lungs. That's not the point. But the point is that sometimes what you're expecting to find, what seems like the obvious answer, is not obvious at all. With the case of schizophrenia, what we might be seeing when we think that marijuana use is causing schizophrenia is that the same age at which people start experimenting with drugs is the age at which they are at risk for developing schizophrenia. And if there is, as I think there is some evidence to show, if there is support for the notion that it can trigger an episode of psychosis, well, if you were prone to getting schizophrenia and you are using marijuana, usually more than once or twice, but a significant amount, that's where you might see a correlation. Whether it's causative or not is another story, and we can talk about the difference between correlation and causation. But even if it is a trigger, and there is some evidence to support that, there is not the evidence to support the notion that it causes schizophrenia.
Right. Well, I mean, can't many things be a trigger for schizophrenia? I mean,
oh, absolutely.
Alcohol.
Alcohol could be, yeah.
Breaking up with a girlfriend.
Exactly. Yeah, stresses. You know, I mean, stresses on the system of any kind precipitate all manner of psychiatric problems that you might have been prone to getting anyway.
Right.
Yeah.
And so, you know, how can you possibly legislate against all the things that could possibly precipitate a psychiatric
Absolutely.
Crisis?
I mean, we're not legislating against skydiving. We don't legislate against football, although some people are suggesting we should.
I'm one of them.
But we, and by correlation, you cannot make illegal an activity that, first of all, people who are intelligent and have good judgment are choosing to engage in anyway. And that's a significant portion of the American population. And of course, nearly half of all Americans have tried marijuana. And if we were really being diligent about prosecuting everyone, imagine what our incarcerations would be like in that situation. You cannot prohibit your way out of the use of a drug like marijuana.
And to me, the strongest argument against any cause-effect relationship between marijuana use and schizophrenia is the simple demographics of schizophrenia. I mean, it's pretty consistent to be between like 1-3% of the population. Mm-hmm. And that holds true in countries that use a great deal of marijuana, like
right.
Canada, and
right.
countries that use very little marijuana, like
right.
Japan.
Exactly. You yeah, know? You don't see, and that's exactly the point of showing how that it's, you know, marijuana does not cause an epidemic of schizophrenia because mm-hmm. in countries that have greater or lesser use, you're not seeing a difference in the percentage mm-hmm. of individuals who use it. I imagine you would ask about the gateway hypothesis. That's mm-hmm. often something that comes up. So if I may talk about that
oh, yeah,
a little bit. Yeah.
Now, the gateway mm-hmm. gateway hypothesis means different things to different people.
Mm-hmm.
I think one of the ways that it's been used in the sense of in opposition to marijuana legalization is that the use of marijuana in some way causes people to use stronger or
right.
more dangerous drugs.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right. And so, first of all, here's where we have to say a few words about correlation and causation. You know, two words that I, as a physician, use quite often to distinguish between problems that are fellow travelers with other problems versus problems that cause other problems. And an example that I think is illustrative is a study that was published in the New England Journal of Medicine a couple of years ago, perhaps tongue-in-cheek, I don't know. But the article was talking about how the per capita consumption of chocolate in different nations of the world is actually very well correlated with the number of Nobel Prizes awarded to individuals in those countries. Again, looking per capita. I don't think, much as I love dark chocolate, I will go on record as being a great fan of chocolate. I don't think it makes you a genius. And I don't think that the per capita or the consumption of chocolate is the reason that there are more Nobel Prizes. There's something else. My guess is it's something related to affluence, because if you can afford dessert, you're probably also able to afford some kind of education. And that increases the odds that you're going to do great things in your life. That doesn't mean that chocolate itself is the cause. So likewise, sure, people who use hard drugs generally used marijuana first. Now, I can't imagine too many people find that surprising. But that's often what's pointed to as being the evidence for the gateway mm-hmm. hypothesis. Look at who is using heroin, and look at and ask them what illicit, meaning illegal, drug did they first use. Well, the chances are it was marijuana. Why? Because marijuana is commonly used. It is the most commonly used illegal drug. And also, it is a reasonably benign drug, so that's part of what contributes to the fact that it's commonly used.
It's the most commonly used illegal drug if you don't consider alcohol and tobacco illegal when
that's
used
right.
by minors.
Oh, good point. Actually, good point. Mm-hmm. Right. And so, of course, it's an illegal use by minors in either case.
Mm-hmm.
So let's set aside that word illegal, mm-hmm. which obviously is a point of contention as to how we should be cracking down on drugs generally among young people? What should we be doing to try to keep them off drugs? Should we be using the criminal justice system, or should we be using preventive education and treatment when needed? But if you set aside the question of what drugs are legal and which are illegal, of course, people who use heroin also first used alcohol. They probably also at some point tried tobacco, whether or not they use it. And you know what? I would say, though I haven't seen the statistics, an overwhelming number have probably tried milk and applesauce at some point in their lives. Now, most people who use milk and applesauce do not go on to use heroin. We know that, right? That kind of goes without saying. Well, the fact is that hundreds of millions of Americans have used marijuana. Virtually none of them, when you look at the percentage, compared to people who haven't used marijuana, the percentages of the use of hard drugs is not that different. And the great majority of people who try marijuana never go on to use any harder drugs. And if you ignore that fact, then you might start thinking about correlation. But if you consider the fact that the great majority of people who try marijuana never have a problem with hard drugs, that right there seems to refute the gateway hypothesis. Now, there is one way in which marijuana is a gateway to harder drugs. And people are now listening intently to know what is that one way. Well, the one way is very simple, and that is that the aforementioned illegal drug dealer who is selling marijuana to children is also selling heroin, cocaine, methamphetamine. I have a patient who his significant other liked marijuana, and he worked in New York, and he would get her marijuana. He himself had had a problem with cocaine, but he had finally kicked it years before. And the dealer who would sell him marijuana kept saying, you know, I'm happy to comp you a little bit of cocaine if you want. You know, you've been such a good customer. I'm happy to just give you a little if you want. And he kept saying no, no, no. And occasionally he would take it and give it to someone else, which I think must have required an amazing amount of willpower. Eventually he weakened, okay, I'll try it. And he was right back to the races. And that's when he came to see me, was when he had started developing a new problem with cocaine that he had gotten courtesy of a marijuana dealer.
It's also a gateway to the criminal justice system.
That's right.
For so many marijuana possession arrests. I believe there are 24,000 in the last count in per year in New Jersey. So this is an entry into this whole system, you know, with the collateral consequences that we talked about before. And for people with limited resources who can't afford to make the records go away, to hire good lawyers, to make the charges go away, you know, they suffer disproportionately.
Sure. And you, I mean, we all have been hearing, at least I hope everybody listening has been hearing about the racial disparities in marijuana arrests between blacks who in New Jersey are almost three times more likely to be arrested for marijuana offenses compared to whites, despite similar usage rates. We also don't consider the socioeconomic bias against individuals who can't defend their way out of a marijuana charge. So in an affluent family, if one of the members of the family is caught with marijuana, it'll cost them a lot of money, but they'll make the problem go away in most cases. In poor families, they have no recourse. They're going to suffer the consequences of that arrest. And that's an injustice that needs to be corrected.
Somewhere in the 1990s, I was working as a nurse supervisor at New Jersey State Prison at Trenton, and I was talking to one of the inmates about the 86% of the 27,000 inmates in the state prison system were black and Hispanic. And I said to him, I thought it was evidence of institutional racism. It wasn't that individuals were racist necessarily, but that the institution itself was racist in in the result, because of the incredibly high percentage of blacks and Hispanics. And in the prison system, and he said, no, Ken, he didn't think it was racism. He thought it was classism.
Oh, interesting.
And I thought that was very interesting. He said, you know, you don't see poor people here in this prison.
Yeah.
Inmates.
And, that is interesting. And whether or not you can tease apart those two, mm-hmm. because, of course, we have an African-American underclass, essentially, in America after so many decades and centuries of bias, that is the case. Maybe we can't separate those two, but we shouldn't need to, because when you're talking about marijuana, you're talking about the wrong drug. And the mm-hmm. fact that so many of those individuals who are in prison are imprisoned or prosecuted or wind up on the wrong track because of a marijuana arrest, mm-hmm. that itself, it should not be happening. Some months ago, I was in a forum where I was debating against Kevin Sabet, who is a respected individual in the opposition to marijuana legalization. We were talking about the experience of Colorado, which had an incredibly high racial disparity in arrests before the legalization of marijuana. And Dr. Sabet, Professor, I guess, Sabet had pointed out that that racial disparity still existed after the legalization. And then it occurred to me that, well, that may be so, and maybe we still have a problem there. But if you're not arresting people for marijuana use, then that racial disparity is much less important than it was. And while you may still bemoan the existence of some institutional racism, legalizing marijuana does make the problem much less of a problem.
It certainly diminishes the impact.
Correct.
If I could just make another comment about the gateway theory, you know, even the DEA doesn't believe in the gateway mm-hmm. theory anymore. And mm-hmm. when they turned down the last petition to reschedule marijuana, mm-hmm. they discussed the gateway theory, and they said they noted the National Academy of Sciences Institute mm-hmm. of Medicine report
That's
that
right.
said there's nothing in marijuana that makes people use harder drugs.
Right.
And they also noted that during the Vietnam War, there was a high percentage of drug use among the soldiers mm-hmm. in Vietnam, but there was no indication of whether or not the marijuana led to the heroin or the heroin led to the marijuana.
Sure, of course.
So it's interesting that you know, even though we have Governor Christie still, you know, hanging his hat on the gateway theory as reason to oppose marijuana legalization, you know, even the DEA doesn't support it anymore.
Right, and you know, am I the most inspired and infallible doctor out there? Presumably
maybe.
Not.
Maybe.
But this isn't even close. This is not a close call in the consideration of whether marijuana should be illegal or not. So if we were to put everything under the same light, all the different drugs, and we see the problems caused by alcohol, we see the problems caused by tobacco, we see the problems caused by marijuana, which of those drugs should be illegal first? Mm-hmm. Well, I can tell you that marijuana should be number three on that list. And some would say, well, but we're already kind of stuck with alcohol and marijuana, alcohol and tobacco, and we don't want to make another drug legal. But if the harm caused by an illegal drug is clearly less than the harm caused by the legal drugs, then we as a society really have no right and certainly no logical leg to stand on to say that that third drug should be illegal. The only morally, ethically, logically consistent argument would be either make all of those legal because it's impractical to make them illegal, or see what happens if you try to make all of those illegal. What happens? Well, we actually know the answer to that question mm-hmm. as far as alcohol is concerned. The prohibition experiment of the 1920s was such an incredible failure that many of the people who supported and pushed for the initiation of alcohol prohibition actually called for its repeal by the end. Not because it didn't work. The fact is that alcohol prohibition did somewhat, not radically, but it diminished alcohol abuse. It even diminished domestic abuse, domestic violence. But it also created such an incredible problem with organized crime that we're still suffering the consequences of that. And the social consequences of alcohol prohibition were so overwhelming that now, 80 years later, we still have no appetite to repeat that experiment. Well, for the people listening who haven't been following this so closely, consider the fact that we have had a prohibition in effect for 78 years, and that prohibition is against marijuana. And because marijuana initially was not so commonly used and its use increased gradually, a lot of people were reasonably unaware of how high of a social and economic toll marijuana prohibition has had. I think we're waking up to it. I think that the conversation we're having today is a reflection of that greater awareness among average people who themselves have no interest in harming the public good. We want to improve the public good. Well, the public good demands that we repeal this prohibition. And in a sense, I think it's fair to say it's time to end prohibition again.
Dr. David Nathan, thank you so much for coming to
thank
our studio.
Thank you so much for having
us
me.
About yes. New Jersey United for Marijuana Reform.
I appreciate that.
In my notes, I saw that you met with Amanda Ryman from Berkeley Patients Group out in the San Francisco Bay Area. And she did such a wonderful study of patients who used medical marijuana at this dispensary that she worked at, over 300 patients. And she saw that a significant percentage of them used marijuana to help them deal with alcohol withdrawal, to help them deal with withdrawal from street drugs and from more dangerous and addicting street drugs, and also from prescription drugs. So it was her hypothesis, I think, that there was that marijuana, with its very low addiction potential, was far from being a gateway drug. It was actually an exit drug for many of these more harmful substances. What are your feelings about
sure.
that?
Sure. I'm somebody who really wants to stick with the science, and I have to admit ignorance about the science on that. So I don't know if there are studies to support that or not. The idea that one might substitute marijuana for alcohol, if adults do that, that's probably generally a very good thing. The question is, will they do that? It would be nice if they did, because marijuana is much less harmful than alcohol in chronic use. So even if it's not an exit, meaning that they don't stop all substance use, if they were able to stop alcohol in favor of marijuana, for adults, I think that would be a good thing. One thing that has been observed, and I have seen the data on this, is that in states that have medical marijuana laws, overdose rates on opiate medications have gone down. I'm sorry, lethal overdoses on opioid drugs has gone down by 25%. This isn't 2%, this isn't 4%, this isn't on the boundary of statistical significance. This is a huge change in those states. And I certainly can understand the theoretical basis of that, which is that cannabinoids seem to enhance the effects of opioids. And by introducing cannabis as an adjunct to opioids, they're both anecdotally as well as statistically in controlled studies, there have been studies to show that substitution does occur, and it's obviously a very positive thing when overdose rates plummet in states with medical marijuana.
Yeah, absolutely. of course, New Jersey has a medical marijuana law, but we were not one of those states. They talked about the 13 states that legalized medical marijuana before New Jersey. That's where they saw the significant decline in opioid overdose death rates.
And I'd like to comment about New Jersey's medicinal marijuana law. I'm glad that we have it. I think that it certainly has plenty of room for improvement, shall we say. But in the one case of medicinal marijuana that I have personal experience with, because as a psychiatrist, there are no psychiatric indications in the state of New Jersey, which would lead me to not even bother registering to be a recommender of medicinal marijuana in New Jersey. But I had a patient who had end-stage cancer, and he couldn't sleep. And part of the reason he couldn't sleep is that he was constantly in pain from cancer that had spread all over his body and was also in his lungs. And I should note that I have his widow's permission to tell this story, which is a really sad one. So he had insomnia, partly as a result of chronic pain all over his body. He couldn't eat. And when he did eat, he got nauseated, but he had no appetite. And so he was losing weight drastically. And from the first time I met him, when he was already quite ill, to the last time I saw him before he died, he became a shadow of himself even over a few months. And in that time course, I kept thinking to myself, this is the case of somebody who should be given medical marijuana. Mm-hmm. If nothing else, it wasn't going to harm this guy. Mm-hmm. And maybe it would help. And it's not even my area. I'm not an oncologist. Mm-hmm. I spoke to his oncologist, who, to her credit, said that she didn't oppose the idea of me trying it, but she just didn't have the familiarity with it. And the notion of it made her vaguely uncomfortable because of how she grew up understanding consequences of marijuana and the kinds of people she knew who would use it. She had very negative ideas about it. But she said, if you are willing to be the point person on this, I'm okay with that, as his oncologist. And so I registered for New Jersey's program. Oh. That wasn't that hard. And I registered that patient. That took a bit of doing. It wasn't an easy process. It took them a little while to get all the paperwork done. And then they went to one of the very few dispensaries in the state of New Jersey. I told him, especially since he had tumors in his lung, I did not want him smoking it, obviously. He was coughing as it was and had trouble with his respiration. I figured, okay, you can try inhaling the vapor, so vaporizing it. Mm-hmm. I said, make sure you get a vaporizer. And so they went there and they did everything I said. They even got the kind of strain that I did a little research to find out what might be most helpful for him. I recommended that. He got that strain and he got a vaporizer, and that all went very smoothly. The problem was that his respiratory status was so compromised, it was so bad, that he couldn't inhale it. And the one time he thought he got enough, he felt better for that afternoon, evening, and overnight. He slept better, and I can't remember if he ate more, but the pain was improved. That was the only time he got any relief. After that, he just couldn't vaporize it. He couldn't inhale it. Mm. And I said, well, then you should get the edible form. Turns out in the state of New Jersey, that was not available to him as an option, which to me is a tragedy. And it certainly was a tragedy for this gentleman, who died some weeks later after I did my best to try to help them figure out a way that maybe they could take the marijuana buds that they had purchased, they still had it, he couldn't consume it, and convert that into some kind of edible, which I'm not very expert on, I don't even like cooking. And the wife was so preoccupied with his care that she could never get around to it. And so this gentleman, who might have benefited from medical marijuana, could not get medical marijuana. And that is the kind of case that to me says that while medical marijuana has its place, some doctors will argue what exactly is it good for, what is it not. Even the most staunch opponents of legalization will not question that that patient of mine should have had access to it, because God bless him, let him do what he needed to do. I think pretty much all of us would agree on that. But if marijuana was legal for personal use, I would not be telling you this story. He would have been able to get an edible because it would have been regulated by the state. He wouldn't have had to travel across the state to get it. He would have had somewhere closer to home. And he could have experienced some relief in the last weeks of his life.
And he started earlier, too. Yeah.
And he didn't. And as much as Governor Christie has claimed to be against the drug war, and for as much as he says that he supported our medical marijuana laws. This is what we have right now in 2015 in the state of New Jersey, and I'm a personal witness to the failure of our medical marijuana laws in New Jersey.
Yeah, thank you for that story, Dr. Nathan, and thank you for your efforts on behalf of that patient. It's certainly seemed to have gone above and beyond the call of duty there. Marijuana really does help with the dying process in so many different ways. It controls pain without over-sedation. It, as you noted, it improves the appetite. It lifts the spirits of dying patients.
That's right. And you know, people say, well, they're just getting high. And in a case like that, especially, so what?
Yeah.
If they can feel better and they can subjectively report that they're better, what is it that we use as the ultimate measure of pain management in somebody that you give morphine to? Well, it's the subjective improvement. Right. And people who use marijuana for purposes such as this report subjective improvement. And I think that we need to acknowledge that, and we need to respect those individuals' rights to do what they need to do to feel better.
Right, absolutely. And the most efficient and effective way to meet the needs of so many people who are in the dying process is to legalize marijuana. The failures of our medicinal marijuana program, you'll never meet the needs of all the patients through through this medicinal marijuana program. But of course, you know, for minors now, you know, marijuana edibles, when they are available in the alternative treatment centers, they were supposed to be available a couple of years ago, for minors at least, not
That's
for
right.
adults.
That's right.
You know, they're still not available. We do put out a little booklet, our organization does it, that instructs patients how to change the flowers that they buy in the alternative treatment centers into edible products if it's more appropriate form of administration for them.
Well, can you give a plug for your website so they can figure out how to get that information?
Definitely, it's cmmnj.org.
Oh, well, there you go.
It should be there.
Yes.
But there was one other question I had for you, and well, first of all, that you did register with the medicinal marijuana program, and it wasn't very difficult, so I'm glad to hear that. But there was that requirement for minors to use who use marijuana to be seen by a psychiatrist before they could have access to medical marijuana for seizure controls and whatnot. I was just wondering, you know, how appropriate that is. You know, it certainly sounds like an appropriate idea, but when you're talking about toddlers and individuals with developmental disabilities,
right.
you know.
I'm not sure how useful that would be. So I, with the caveat that I'm not a child psychiatrist, and I've often said, having raised my own children and also having done a little child psychiatry in my training, that children and teens are a different species from adults. but again, just what you're saying, that toddlers, you know, a psychiatric assessment of a toddler is kind of an interesting feat to accomplish. Same with people with profound developmental disabilities, who are, I know, a number of the individuals for whom medical marijuana is recommended for seizure disorders and things like that, that go along with whatever kind of developmental problems that they have. With kids, we talk about consent versus assent, and adults need to consent to treatment. Children need to assent to treatment, or should be encouraged to assent, which means that the parents make the decision, not the kids. I mean, if you're going to evaluate somebody, evaluate the parents, but I'm not saying that they should. I'm just saying they're the more appropriate individual because they're the ones making that decision. And children, really, their job is not to show the capacity to consent to treatment. It's good when you can get them to agree that, yes, this is the thing I want to do. But I think for many of the people you're describing, they can't give their assent to treatment because they're not really that aware of the pros and cons.
Yeah, so I'm just... I mean, I think it's an entirely inappropriate requirement for... juvenile access, but at any rate. And one other question about correlation versus causation. Now, certainly...
Hang on, you might want to start that over again. Say thank you, Lefty.
Thank you, Lefty.
No, I meant Lefty should say thank you.
One other question about correlation versus causation. Now, certainly no one is recommending marijuana be available for minors in the state, but some people are taking the study that showed IQ differences in teens who use marijuana as gospel, as causation, a cause-effect relationship between the use of marijuana and a decrease in the IQ. And I don't think that's ever been proven in a cause-effect relationship. I think that people have shown a correlation between between teen use of marijuana and a subsequent decline in IQ.
Right.
But you know, whether or not you can blame that on the on marijuana use itself or whether other factors were involved, you know, I think that that's still up in the air at any rate. What are your thoughts on that?
My comment on that is that when I look at the data, I see that correlation not just with decrease in IQ, and of course IQ itself is a controversial subject because of potential ethnic and gender biases and how we measure IQ. But even setting that aside, there are correlations not only with underage marijuana use and IQ decreases that endure after the use. We also see a correlation between early marijuana use and low motivation. And I think for parents of kids who have experienced issues or problems with marijuana use, or who started at a surprisingly young age, I think that they would not be surprised to hear that it might affect function. Now, what you're pointing out is something that I can't speak authoritatively to because I can't go beyond the data that does show a good correlation. But my reading of the data, which starts to become more about belief than about just science, but it is my belief that the younger you start, and by young, I'm talking about middle schoolers, early high schoolers, and the more you do it, and I'm talking about daily use. So if you start very young, and if you start, and if you use marijuana very heavily, I think that there probably is some effect on neuropsychiatric development. So I do believe that that's the case. Putting that out there, I don't think that that changes the argument about the legalization of marijuana for adults. If anything, all of the other arguments, for example, the need to make a distinction between adult and underage use, those are arguments to legalize it. The fact that it may be harmful for young people, let's focus on those young people. Let's focus on their education. Let's focus on prevention of early recreational use. Let's focus our efforts on preventing the diversion of marijuana from adults to children. Right now, that's not really the focus so much. The focus is on trying to stop everybody, and guess what? It doesn't work.
Now, you know, it just seems to me that children who you know, middle school children or even younger who are using marijuana regularly, it seems to me that that may be more of a symptom of an underlying problem that hasn't been addressed rather than the actual problem itself.
And I haven't spoken to that at all. Again, partly because I'm an adult psychiatrist, right? So I'm not looking at those developmental issues. I just don't. It's not part of my job.
But there are very interesting studies done by Dr. Melanie Dreher in Jamaica. I don't know if you're familiar with them, but she studied Jamaican pregnant women. And many of the Jamaican pregnant women used marijuana either as a tea or they smoked marijuana. She had a control group of pregnant Jamaican women who did not use marijuana. And she followed these children, these women, to term, and then she examined the children. And she could find no difference now between the infants who were exposed to marijuana and the infants who were not exposed to marijuana. Now, you don't get any younger, you know, exposure to marijuana than in utero. So, you know, it just seems to me that, you know, if you're not seeing the differences, you know, with that young exposure, you know, why would you see differences when they're 12 or 13 or 15?
Well, I'd say a couple things about that. One is that, you know, I'm not familiar with that study, nor the general research on that. I do know that there have been studies that also show that there could be a problem with in utero development when the mother consumes marijuana. But I just don't know. But so there's the issue of what studies are you looking at, which ones are better than others. And even doctors will disagree about things like that. that's one point I would make. The other one I would make is that what I don't know is the degree to which the active ingredients of marijuana, of cannabis, actually get to the fetus. So I just don't know the answer to that question, mm-hmm. but I will mm-hmm. say that that probably has a lot to do with the degree to which we would or would not judge cannabis use to be safe in maternal use, because it may be the case. There are drugs that simply don't get to the fetus, and there are drugs that are preferentially pulled in by the developing fetus. So a lot depends on that.
That's a very interesting observation. Thank you. Thank you so much for your insights here,
Dr. My Nathan. Pleasure.
Really, it was a pleasure speaking with you and pleasure having you here.
Thank you.
For more information about the Coalition for Medical Marijuana in New Jersey, join us at our free public meetings on the second Tuesday of every month at the Lawrence Township Library in Mercer County, New Jersey, from 7 to 9 p.m. Snacks are served and all are welcome. Remember,
every 42 seconds, someone is arrested for marijuana.
Every 42 seconds, someone is arrested for marijuana.
Every 42 seconds, somebody's arrested for marijuana.
Every 42 seconds, someone is arrested for marijuana.
Every 42 seconds, someone's arrested for marijuana.
Every 42 seconds, someone is arrested for marijuana.
Every 42 seconds, somebody is arrested for marijuana.
Every 42 seconds, someone is arrested for marijuana.
Cada 42 segundos, está uno arrestado por marihuana.
Every 42 seconds, somebody is arrested for...
Every 42 seconds, someone in this country is arrested for marijuana.
Chaque 42 secondes, il y a un monde pour marijuana.
Every 42 seconds, someone is arrested for marijuana.
Every 42 seconds, someone is arrested for marijuana.
Every 42 seconds, someone is arrested for marijuana. It could be you.